Good morning, everyone. There are few days in the world like a June day in New England. Yes?
Yes.
It's just amazing, and I am so pleased and grateful that you have decided to come here and be with us here to worship rather than being somewhere else. And when you do get somewhere else, I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful experience of this beautiful June day. So welcome, everybody. Glad to see you. I hope that if you can, fill out the friendship roster, let us know you're here. If you would like to be in touch with me, please let me know, and I'll be happy to be back in touch with you. Also, this is the fourth and last week of the worship experiment, in which we have done two things: moved the sermon to earlier in the service, near the scripture, and moved the prayer service to the end. So if you would like to let your comments be known, the deacons will be talking about this process this Wednesday. So are there some forms out there? There are some worship feedback forms still on the table out here. So please write down your thoughts and feel free to give your thoughts to one of the deacons. And what are the deacons here this morning?
Oh, cool.
We have four deacons here this morning. You can get your thoughts to. And then one other announcement, one small change on my side. I was working on this sermon this week, and I was pounding sand. So I decided to change the sermon. And so we have a different scripture today and a different sermon. And that happens sometimes. Maybe it'll come back later, but there's a different sermon that I was planning to do. And the different sermon is: why are we afraid of goodness? Other announcements this morning.
Thank you. Good morning. A couple quick announcements. Youth group is canceled for today. We will resume in September. And if you have questions, come see me. I do want to call your attention to the announcement page in the bulletin. There's a slew of things to know about, one of which is that we need volunteers to help out with Sunday school over the summer. Bethany and I are off from after today through the middle of August, and we need somebody here each Sunday to take kids for the children's time or after the children's time to do an activity. If you are interested in that, please come and see me and let me know, because you'll have a little activity sheet with a lesson plan and everything all spelled out, so it's not hard. We just need somebody here to do that, so please come and talk to me. Also, in the bulletin, you may notice that we need frozen lemonade, men's underwear, and socks. Let you read about that. This is the sign-up sheet for what we call coffee hour during the winter time and lemonade on the lawn in the summer. Next Sunday, we will start having lemonade on the lawn, but again, we need people to help out with that. So this will be in the community hall on the bulletin board, or I'll leave it right out here for today. So maybe I'll just take the community hall and leave it there, because that's where people expect to see it. So sign up, please, and help out. That would be absolutely wonderful.
Thank you. I am the energizer bunny. My battery is going down, I'm slowing down. So for the last month and a half, some old faithful people have signed up. Before that, for 4 months, I called on people who hadn't been coming to church. And we had good luck with them for 4 months. Now we're posting something because I need some help. I'm back in the kitchen today myself. I love doing it, but I don't want to do it every week, but I love baking for it. So, please sign up.
Thank you, Gwendolyn.
I want to let all of you know the Blueberry Festival is really our major fundraiser. We're going to be having an organizational meeting for it on Wednesday at 4 o'clock. Anyone in the congregation who would like to participate, you can surely think of an hour you could come to the meeting or you could see somebody on the investment team and say that you would like to sign up. But additionally, I would like to add that we're going to have a barbecue that's kind of a last minute thing. And all of you are invited. We're going to be providing chicken and burgers and hot dogs, and then anyone who wants to come, if you want to bring a little cider, some lemonade or something, that would be greatly appreciated, but if not, I always have little stuff on hand. So I hope to see as many of you that would like to come, you come. Something to try. Thank you.
I just want to mention that I'm not on call to care this week. Stephanie Cormier is. I'm Sue Ann, and there is a call to care meeting in the sanctuary after the church. Thank you.
Good morning. The pie guy would like to point out that we're wrapping up the sale of pies for the year. We're going to go through the month of June, and at least one of us will make some pies. So today, we had a council meeting, and we are going to be selling pies, and it's going to be immediately after service. So grab your pies early, is what I'm trying to say.
Good morning. One of the things we do to advertise the Blueberry Festival is we march in the 4th of July parade, and it is fun. It really is. And I know a lot of you go to the parade because I see you at the parade. So if you're going to the parade, wouldn't it be fun to help hold the banner and represent South Freeport Church in the parade? So far, Deborah and Cole and I are doing it. Maybe Bill, are any grandchildren going to be here this summer? Bill has been a tried and true member of our team if you're available. But we need a couple people, and we also need someone to dress up in the blueberry costume, which I will do if, you know, push comes to shove. But we give out candy, which also makes you really popular. So anyways, that's the plan, and I hope you want to be part of it because it's really fun. Thank you. It's on the 4th of July.
I am really tired of standing up here and sounding like Darth Vader. So I am the voice of your conscience once again. No, I'm not going to smile. I don't feel like smiling. Here is the deal, folks. There's no free lunch. And if you have caught the certain tenor of the announcements in our church for the last couple of weeks, it is that we are looking for volunteers. It just doesn't happen if people don't volunteer. There are a few people who give generously of their time and effort, and they are spectacular, but they're getting tired. We need more people. We haven't been getting any volunteers, so if you're going to start, if you get a phone call, the correct answer is yes, I'd love to. The summer is our vacation, but in the fall, we're starting up again. Uncle Sam wants you.
You should say Joe wants you.
On that happy note.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
This morning's meditation is from the Awakening Together community. The seed of the flower is within you. Like all seeds, it needs water and light. With your water and light, the flower shall grow and bloom as you. Without your water or your light, the seed shall wilt, but it will not die. Be at peace.
Thank you. consider scripture this morning. It is good to remember that although scripture comes out of a tradition of church and a tradition of worship, it began in the human heart. And it began in the human experience of conversation with God, the stories about ourselves that we tell God, and the stories that we listen to as God feeds back to us who we really are. And we see this most especially in the Psalms, and the Psalms come in many, many forms. This morning we're going to hear a short one. It is a psalm of what's called supplication, begging of God for a response. But even more deeply than that, one can hear behind it the human experience of uncertainty, of waiting in the hours before daylight, of waiting for what dawn will show, like that of a watchman on the walls in the defense of a city. And what is being sought if you listen to the human experience of it is for God to provide guidance for the human heart so that we might trust and let love and not fear be in control of our lives. And so out of uncertainty, in this conversation with God, this real conversation about what's actually going on in our human experience, comes a shift from a place of fear to a place of trust. And then I've changed the reading from the Gospel this morning. I had one from the New Testament, Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, but instead I've changed it to one of the most well-known stories from Luke's Gospel, the story of the Gerasene demoniac, the story of Jesus' healing of this poor man. But the story actually is not so much about the healing, but about the response of the people around him as they witness his healing. And where that went, because it doesn't go where you think it's going to go at all. Linda, will you come up, please, and read the scripture with us?
Psalm 130 can be found in your pew Bibles on page 562. A Song of Ascents. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits. And in his word, I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all its iniquities. The New Testament reading is from Luke 8:26-39. Then they arrived at the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee. As he stepped out on the land, a man of the city had demons met him. For a long time he had worn new clothes, and he did not live in a house but in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he fell down before him and shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man, for many times it had seized him, and he would be kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles. But he would break the bonds and be driven by the demon into the wilds. Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" He said, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. They begged him not to order them to go back into the abyss. Now there on the hillside, a large herd of swine was feeding. And the demons begged Jesus to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine. And the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When the swineherds saw what had happened, they ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came out to see what had happened. And when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by demons had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with a greater fear. So he got into the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." So he went away, proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. So ends the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
invite the kids to come up and join me. So here's the story. My daughter, one Friday afternoon, went to pick her daughter up from school, Adelaide up from school, and Adelaide got into the car, and her mother said to her, "Oh, Adelaide, how was your day?" And Adelaide was quiet. And her mother said, "Addie," she calls her Addie, "Addie." And finally, Adelaide said, "Well," she said, "I did not get to pick a prize out of the treasure box." Now, you have to understand that the young Friday afternoon, they get in a circle around the big rug, and everybody who's been good during the week gets to pick up a little prize out of the treasure box. And Adelaide didn't get to do that. So her mother said to her, she says, "Oh, Adelaide, what happened?" And Adelaide was quiet for a minute, and she said, "Well, I was talking at reading time." Her mother thought about that. Now, talking at reading time is not really a big deal. She said, "Addie, what really happened?" And Addie was quiet for a minute, and then she said, "Well," she said, "I scratched somebody." "Oh," thought her mother. She said, "Want to tell me a little bit more?" And Addie said, "Well," she said, "there was blood." So her mother said, "So why did you do that?" And Addie thought about it like that was a really interesting question. And she said, "I don't know." And so her mother, you know, was quiet for a second. And Adelaide finally said, "Well, I guess I was tired and cranky." She's getting pretty smart. She figured that's a better thing to say than "I just felt like it." Well, that's the end of the story, but I wonder, what do you think Addie could have done if she was feeling tired and cranky that might have been better than scratching somebody in the face? What do you think? Of course, we never do things like that, do we? Always do. What do you think could be, for example, could she have thought about what would it be like if somebody scratched me in the face and there was blood? I wouldn't like that, so maybe I won't do it to somebody else. Or what else? Maybe she could go to the teacher and say, "I'm feeling tired and cranky." And the teacher would give her something else to do to keep her busy for a while. But she had some choices, and part of growing up is learning that you have choices even when you're feeling bad, because you know what? Adults get cranky too sometimes. You ever seen an adult get cranky? So all of us can learn what are some of the other choices we have besides just striking out at somebody. And you know what? One of the great ways I do that is to say the Lord's Prayer quietly to myself. So let's say it together. We hold hands. Everybody, our Father, the Lord,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debts. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you so much for coming up. So, something really puzzles me. Has for a long time, and I would like to share my puzzlement with you. How come we are so good at responding to crisis and death and tragedy? Really, I mean, if you think about it, we are good at it. It's not just that there's so much of these things in our lives, but someone dies, we know how to step in with support, prayers, casseroles. It's very helpful. As I've been talking to people this week, people have been thinking about the suicides of those two celebrities, Kate Spade and Anthony Bourdain. It's on everybody's lips, they're thinking about it and wondering what happened and what might have been helpful. A hurricane, a weather event happens, and a town gets drowned, and heroes show up to save people, and there's food and shelter and support and news. Remember what happened with the Boston Marathon bombing 3 years ago? There were heroes there, and then it was all, you know, Boston's strong, wow, it's just it's wonderful, we knew what to do. It's not that we love crisis and death and tragedy, it's just that we're good at it. We know what to do, pretty much. It's even, how can I say this, trustworthy. We know that bad things happen, even to good people. They just do. They're inevitable, like mud season, black fly, and tourists. So get over it, we say. You know, I have a neighbor across the street who says, enjoy life and keep your gun in. Now, here's the interesting thing. We don't seem to have the same confidence in that goodness happens in life. We don't. We're awkward with goodness. I'll never forget a woman I knew, a friend, this is years ago, a friend who grew up very poor, and she married a high school music teacher who doesn't make a lot of money, is that right, David? High school music teacher. They both were very involved in their church, they're leaders in their church. They raised three children in a very modest home, in a very modest neighborhood. They never traveled, they never owned a new car. And then one day, an elderly aunt died, and they inherited some money, not a lot of money, but some money, and they inherited a somewhat nicer house. And here's the point, they inherited a hot pink Cadillac convertible. Now, my friend was kind of given pause by what to do with this hot pink Cadillac convertible. She never dreamed of owning anything remotely like it, but she figured, you know what, I'm 55 years old, I'm going to go for it. And she wanted to share her good fortune, so she started driving her new wheels to church on Sundays. But the response she got was not quite the response that she expected. Her friends kind of stood aloof and pretended to notice, and then said things like, well, isn't that a bright color? What are you going to do with it? And one of her best friends actually said that she was showing off her inheritance. And that hurt. She had thought her friends might celebrate her good news with her. Instead, folks just didn't seem to know what to do with it. Now, had she parked the pink Cadillac in the garage and reported to her church family the death of her beloved aunt and all the challenge of all the work around the inheritance and what to do with the ghastly car, all the work and all the sadness, imagine all the goodwill and support she would have had from all her friends. You see, can we just laugh at ourselves for a moment? I don't know why exactly goodness makes us feel awkward. But it does. In the gospel story this morning, the Gerasene demoniac, the man possessed with demons, was restored to his right mind. So do his neighbors hold a party? Do they bring him casseroles? No, the story says they are terrified of him, and they beg Jesus, the healer, to pack up and leave town. Here's this beautiful thing that Luke tells us about. I love this phrase, this beautiful picture of a man now clothed and in his right mind. clothed in his white wine. What a beautiful picture. He had been chained and beaten and banished from the graveyard because he was not safe to himself or to anybody else. Now he's clothed in his right mind, at peace, sitting quietly by Jesus, and nobody has any idea what to do with it. I believe that Jesus comes to each one of us, clothe us, and put us in our right mind, to restore us to the knowledge of God's love and our own innocence. There's an expression, do you know it, that someone cleans up good? In Jesus' eyes, we all clean up good. The shame of the past fades away. Seizures of self-condemnation stop the running here and there to find an elusive peace. Ceases. What does it look like when someone is clothed and in their right mind? Some of you heard the story I told a few weeks ago about my brother that has Parkinson's. And he's had Parkinson's for a long time now, and he's had to retire. He has a lot of difficulties. And remember, he told me, though, that as much as he would never want to wish Parkinson's on anybody, there are some key things that he has learned because of his Parkinson's. One, how to love himself. Two, how to live each day. Three, how not to be afraid of dying, not even a little bit. My brother is clothed in his right mind. So here's how I understand it. The world that we see all the time around us, convulsed as it is with fear and rage and guilt and I don't know what else, is a story we tell ourselves. The story always ends in the same way, with death and sadness. And we become so used to the story that we forget that there is another fundamental story to tell ourselves. And in this other story, we have never been separated from our Creator. We have never been separated from our own innocence. There is no need for fear, for shame, or for blame. I want to take a look very gently at our own joys and concerns. And this is true of every church I belong to. And it's not a criticism, it's just that something I'm noticing. There are always lots of people that we're concerned for. Yes? Absolutely. People who have experienced loss or woundedness or struggle or death. And it's a beautiful thing to be real and to be in community. So let's always pray that everyone may be restored and know that they are not alone. But look at the joys. They tend to be about birthdays and anniversaries and graduations, all wonderful things. Estimable things, wonderful news to share. But what of the healings, the transformations, the glad news about what God is doing in our lives, gratitude for today, forgiveness for the past? Why are we so quiet about these things? Why so awkward? Would it be so terrible to stand up and proclaim one day, today I find myself clothed in my right mind. But tomorrow I have no answer, but today I'm good. Or just stand up and say, thank you, God. Thank you, God, for today. You see, the story that we tell ourselves becomes the story that we tell others, becomes the story we believe, which is the story we pass on to our children. And I grant you that this world appears today brutally challenging. But is that all there is? What good news do we have to pass on that transforms us? I'm not talking about YouTube, miracles. I'm not talking about the clip from the Twitter account. I'm talking about stories of dignity and courage from our own lives, and decency and gratitude. How did they get passed on unless we tell them? You ever wanted to say, you know something, I've been with this story about world, about how my place in it for so long, I'm just done, I don't want to pass it on. Today I am clothed in my right mind, today I remember God's love and strength for me. Wow. You see, this is not about the joys and concerns. This is about what we proclaim with our lives. So let's always be real about where we sorrow and struggle. That's a given. But my question to you is, can we be as real about the gratitude and the overcoming? Our hymn is Seek Ye First, number 349.
Thank you. Lord, is your God. May they defend your lives with your grace and peace. Amen.
Prayers to my friend Gloria, who's going to have open heart surgery tomorrow.
Bill and I would like prayers for the Rentz family. Edie Rentz was the ninth grade teacher at Fripper High School for 30 years, and my dearest friend, she passed away this week.
And she passed away from us.
I have two really big joys. Our daughter is going to be 60 next week, and Jim and I are celebrating our 65th wedding anniversary weekend.
Springs last week, and after a tumultuous time, she seems at peace with her life and her occupation and her new man, and has made a lot of big decisions. So it's nice.
Praise God.
Yes.
Yes. Today I'm thinking of my friend Jane Myrick, who it's her birthday today. And it was a year ago today that her husband passed away of a heart attack. And she and I have been walking and sharing fond memories together. So maybe a birthday note, she's at 63 Windsor Post Road, and she'll be coming to church with me in a couple of weeks, but she's having a nice birthday today.
Well, as you probably read, Dick and I had a wonderful marriage too, but not quite as long as Kathy and Jim. But we are so pleased to have had four children and four in-laws, son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws. But we also have eight grandchildren. And this week we were so pleased to get a telephone call from one of our granddaughters who had just graduated from college and wanted to take a break from being at home, and called and said, I'd love to come. Can I come? And I said, when? And she said, oh, in about an hour. And I said, no, we're busy. You can come on Saturday and do what we're doing. And so I'm very happy to introduce you to Abby Baldwin.
I've always been a person that's been grateful, but it's just this past year that I can just say I'm happy for the first time in my life, and it's been a long, long journey, and I almost don't want to say that because I don't want to wait for the other shoe to drop, but I really mean it, and I'm just so grateful and happy at the same time. They're happening at the same time, which is amazing to me.
Good evening.
Prayers for my friend Fleeta Pelletier and her family. They lost their 17-year-old daughter unexpectedly on Monday.
I'm so glad we can share, Peter and I can share our 59th anniversary with the Laughlins. Married the same day, the same year, in Connecticut, all four of us. Different towns, but...
I just think it would be apropos, if you will, to ask for prayers for this coming week's meeting in Singapore between our president and the president of North Korea. The God's presence will be there, and the things will work out for the world.
Indeed. Thank you, Bob. Then let us join again in the spirit of prayer. So Lord, we put ourselves in your hands, and we offer to you what is real to us, what is in our minds and hearts. Help us to always face what is in us. Save us from wasting time with blame of ourselves or others, as you have given us a fresh start. Save us from holding on to grievances, for you have given us a clean slate. Save us from living small, for you have given us a Holy Spirit of power and goodness. And so, dear God, may our lives preach and proclaim more than these words, but your life in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh.
at each day's waking, embrace God. At each day's working, serve God. At each day's reflection, praise God. At each day's ending, thank God. Amen.